Welcome to the second lecture. Sorry, I had a couple of technical issues to sort out. So today, I want to go through some of the functional analytic aspects that will be involved in this course. So I want to cover some of the ideas come from functional analysis. So let me start by recalling the following. So Banach spaces. Okay. So I want to talk about B is a K vector space for a choice of K being R or C, okay? Typically, when we're talking about Banach spaces, I will typically stick with K being C, complex numbers, so the field is complex. So, so such a space is equipped with a norm. So we have a norm on B, and the norm induces a distance. Okay, so there's nothing really particular here. So then, so maybe I'll denote this with a lowercase b here. So this pair is a Banach space. So this is a Banach space if the induced topology is a complete metric space. So the induced topology from the metric. Okay, so the quintessential example that we have, and something that would be that is of significance to us, is when the underlying space is a Hilbert space. So what is that? So B equals, typically denoted H, is a Hilbert space if this norm polarizes. Maybe I should write that in. Okay, so what does that mean? It means that it satisfies the following relation. So for vectors x and y, we have that this norm is equal to 2x squared plus 2y squared. Okay, so in that case, we have an induced inner product . So what is this inner product? This is given as 1/4 of x plus y squared minus x minus y squared minus I x plus I y squared plus I x minus I y squared. So this part is, of course, omitted. This part is omitted when the field is real. Okay, so typically though, we're not going from, so okay, so this satisfies, I should say, first that this satisfies this relation. Okay, so typically we're not going to be going from Banach spaces to Hilbert spaces. Typically we'll be dealing with Hilbert spaces given by such a norm. Okay, such an inner product which induces a norm in this way. Okay, so next in functional analysis, what is really of significance is to consider functionals. I mean, this is why it's called functional analysis. So there are two spaces with respect to this. So the first is the adjoint space. So these are the functionals. So these are the maps which are conjugate linear and continuous. Okay, so this is the adjoint space. And when we look at linear maps and continuous, this is typically what we call the dual space. Okay, so of course we have that these spaces are isomorphic to each other, but with an antilinear map, right? So it's an antilinear isomorphism or a conjugate linear, whichever way you want to say it. Okay, so that's the first. So of course these two spaces are going to be equal if we have a real space. I mean, we don't have a notion of conjugate linear then, right? So we can only look at the dual space when the vector spaces are real vector spaces. So another important space that we obtain for functional analysis is of course the double dual, right? So the double dual is the double dual is defined as the dual space. So again, this space B star, the adjoint space, is again a Banach space. So we can now look at the functionals over that, and this is the double dual or the double adjoint space. And so recall that B is said to be reflexive. Before I get into that, let me just first define something. So the so-called evaluation functional, right? So the evaluation functional takes us from B into B star star, which is of course equal to B star star. So how is this defined? This is defined, we take an element in B, and we're acting on, so x is in B and f is in B star. So how does this act? This simply acts by f acting on x. Okay, so this is the so-called evaluational functional, and it's not hard to see that the range of EV is a closed linear subspace of B star star. So recall again, so these are notions I hope that you've seen already, just recalling them. So B is called reflexive if EV is an isomorphism. Okay. So that's the first thing I wanna really talk about. So Banach spaces. So what are some examples of Banach spaces, right? So let's, since we're interested in geometry, let's think about some geometric examples. So examples. So let's fix a density on our manifold M, and let E be a complex vector bundle. So E is a vector bundle over M, and H is a Hermitian metric on E. So let's define, so in the example I'm really defining something. So for one, for P in the range between, so for P in the range between 1 and infinity, sorry, including 1, we define the space U in, so we say that U is in LP of E if and only if, so this is by definition, U is a measurable section of E. Okay, so remember that I said last time we can talk about measurable actually independent of this mu. So this does not require mu, but where mu is required is in the following, in setting up the following norm. U P LP of ME so we ask for this to be finite. So for P equal to infinity, what we ask is that U L infinity of M E is said to be the essential supremum X in M such that U X H X is finite. Okay, so I want to remark here so L infinity, as I've defined it, does not require mu. Okay, so it only depends on really on the manifold and this notion of measurability that we've talked about. So actually, it's independent of mu. If we change mu from one mu to another, L infinity doesn't change. It only depends on H. The metric, the Hermitian metric on E. Okay. So, what can we say? So, with respect to these definitions, so P in the range 1 to infinity, oops, infinity included. So, L, P, M, E are Banach spaces. In the range 1 to infinity, LP, M, E are reflexive. For P equal to 2, we have that L2 of M, E is a Hilbert space. And what is this inner product is precisely calculated to be equal to, so M H X U X V X D mu X. Okay, so I should also have remarked that we're really interested in separable Hilbert spaces or separable Banach spaces. But if we have in this setting, if we have a sigma finite measure, so a measure where we can write let me not talk about that at that level of generality. M is a separable space, so actually we obtain that L2 and LP are also separable. Okay, so separable means that there's a countable dense subset. Okay, so all these spaces are separable. They exist countable dense subset. Okay. So, I hope that none of this causes any issues. So, the next thing I want to talk about are operators, right? So we now have spaces, and we want to talk about operators that act between these spaces. Okay, so let me just. Okay. So I'll start with the definition. So a linear map that takes us from some domain in B1. So B1 and B2 are now Banach spaces, right? So throughout B1, B2 are Banach spaces. A linear map where Dom T is a linear subspace is called an operator. So just, if you're reading this in the literature, maybe it's also important to fix some notation that people talk about in the literature. So sometimes people write B1 to B2 unbounded, right? So that means that it's really that means that it's defined on a subspace. Dom T of B1, right? Okay, so that's just a remark. So let me also fix some notation now. So Dom T, so this is the domain of T. The kernel of T, so this is exactly the U in Dom T such that TU is 0. Okay. The range of T is U in TU in B2 such that U is in Dom T. Okay. Graph of T, this is exactly the U TU such that U, so this is a subspace of B1 cross B2 such that U is in Dom T. Now, when we have such an operator, we have an operator norm, right? And this would be of significance later. So the operator norm is defined as U of D is U in the Banach space plus, so this is B1 plus T of U B2 squared squared. And last but not least, we write S is contained in T if Dom S is contained in Dom T and SU is equal to TU on TU for all U in Dom S. Okay. So these are in general called unbounded operators, right? And we'll see why in a minute. So we should really think about the algebra of unbounded operators, right? So namely, when we deal with operators defined on the whole, yes. Sorry, the index here should be T, not D. That's right. So, as I was saying, the thing that one needs to worry about when we deal with these operators are really domain issues. Okay, so if we take two operators T and S, the domain of T plus S is of course going to be the domain of T intersect the domain of S. If we compose two operators, T and S, then what's this domain? So this is going to be U in the domain of T such that TU is in the domain of S. So, an important point is ST, you're right. Yes. Unbounded. So the remark I want to make is that it could happen that Dom T plus S is zero or Dom ST is zero. Okay, so we really could have operators that are only defined on zero. Okay. So, let me just quickly flesh out an exercise so you could attempt. So you could show that S plus T is equal to T plus S. S plus T plus U is equal to S plus T plus U. S plus 0 is equal to S. 0 S is contained in S0, which is equal to 0. S minus S is contained in 0. STU equals to STU. STU plus u is contains st plus su, and st plus is distribute, so su plus tu. So that's exercise one, I guess. And two, if we have, okay, well, actually I'll just give that one. And let's go back to our normal color. So, no, you have to really deal with domain issues, right? So the question was, shouldn't 0s be the same as s0? And no, and this is I think really highlights the point, because you have to really deal with the domain of the operator. For unbounded operators, it's not enough just to give the mapping, you have to give both the mapping and the domain. So 0s and s0 are different operators. Okay, so very quickly, let me just make another definition. So a whole list of definitions. So here I'm just really rehearsing things and just recalling facts, right? So T is injective. I'm not going to change colors to orange. I think I'll just underline. If the kernel is the zero subspace, okay? T is densely defined, and this is a very important notion as we'll see, if DOM T is a dense subspace of B1. Okay, the next notion is also an extremely important notion. So T is closed if graph T in B1 cross B2 is a closed subset. Okay, so the notation here then is we write T is we write B1, B2. Okay. So maybe I'll just write an exercise here. So exercise T is closed if and only if the domain of T with respect to the operator norm is a Banach space. Okay. So T is bounded, so B1 to B2 is bounded if DOM T is the whole space and there exists some finite constant such that T of X is bounded against this constant. Oops. For all X in B1. So this is also something you would have seen, hopefully. So T is bounded if and only if T is continuous. So the notation here is T is in B1, B2, or maybe B1, B2. So both of these notations are used in the literature, so it's good to just be aware of it. Okay, now lastly, T is invertible, so an operator is invertible if it is injective and the inverse is bounded. Okay. Well, actually, let me rehearse that, because that's a bit imprecise. If it is injective with dense, okay, so with dense range and T inverse U is U for all U in the range of T. Okay, so the point here is that if we have dense range, then it's clear that if we have, sorry, there's a CT here, that if we have such an estimate, then it extends to a bounded operator on all of B2. Okay. Alright, so why do we care about closed operators? So we will see lots of examples of closed operators in time to come. But the first thing... Well, it's a definition. So definition's always if and only if. So I'm defining the notion of T to be invertible if it is a map that is injective with dense range with this estimate. Okay? So why do we care about closed operators? So closed operators are really the bread and butter of what we'll deal with in time to come. But let me just give the following theorem that sort of highlights their significance. So it's a very important theorem of operator theory, which is called the closed graph theorem. Okay, so the closed graph theorem says that if we have an operator which is closed, so i.e. It has some, so here again, I'm not saying that it is an operator on all of B1. Here it has a domain, but if we assume that the domain is domain of T is all of B1, then well, maybe I'll write implies T is bounded. Okay, so somehow closed operators are almost bounded operators. So what really stops them from being bounded is really their domain being large enough. Okay. So maybe I'll just write down something if you want to try your hand at this. These are not exercises that I think are going to appear in the tutorial or anything, but these are just things that you can think about. So suppose we have a bounded operator. So here, if I'm omitting B1 to B2, it means back into itself. Okay, and we have a closed operator. S inverse T for when S is injective, and T inverse when T is injective, are all closed operators on B. Okay, so when we compose lots of different kinds of operators, we end up still with closed operators. So the last thing I'll sort of talk about in terms of operators is another very important theorem, which is the open mapping theorem. It's also something we will use a lot in time to come. So if we have a bounded surjection, T between Banach spaces, B1 and B2, a bounded surjection between Banach spaces is always an open map. Okay, so what does this mean? This means that if we have U, which is a subspace of B1 open, then T of U as a subspace of B2 is open. Okay. So let me talk a little bit more about closed operators, because they are very important to us. So an important criteria an important criteria for closeness is the following, right? So T is closed if and only if, whenever we have a sequence, I'll write it in the next line here, whenever we have a sequence in the domain of the operator, and this sequence converges to U, and we also have that T of UN converges to some V, then we have that U is in the domain of T and V is equal to TU. So this is really nothing but just rephrasing the graphical criteria for nothing very deep going on here. So you can just unravel the definition and write this out. But this is often very useful in actually proving that an operator is closed. Okay, so connected with closeness is closability of an operator. Okay, so let's define that. So definition. An operator T is closable if there exists some closed operator, such that T is contained in this closed operator. Okay? So for such an operator, we obtain a smallest closed operator, right? So for T closable, there exists T closed corresponding to the closure of the graph. So, i.e., there exists a T such that obviously T closure is closed, or T bar is closed. Okay, so that gives us with that I want to really highlight another important criteria for detecting closability. So let me just just write this down. So T is closable if and only if when UN is in DOM, so maybe I'll write this in the next line. UN is in the domain of T, UN goes to zero, and T UN goes to V. This implies, so maybe I'll move this a bit. This implies that V is equal to zero. Okay, so how are we doing with time? So let me the proof of this, I was hoping to actually prove this. So the direction, this direction is easy, right? So I'll leave this as an exercise. So it's really this direction that's interesting. So suppose it suffices to show that when we take the closure, so if I consider the closure of the graph, it suffices to show that we cannot have two sequences converging to the same x. Namely, suppose that xn txn converges to xy and xn tilde txn tilde converges also to some xz. Okay? So this would be the only thing that would make the graph, the closure of the graph of T from being given by an operator itself. So now let me set yn to simply be xn minus xn tilde. So obviously this goes to zero, and yn by linearity is again in the domain of T. And I have that tyn converges to y minus z. But from the criteria, that gives us that y minus z is equal to zero. So so that means that the limit, if we take sequences and we take the limit, then that limit is going to always be unique in the pairs x and y, right? So this tells us that the graph of T closure is precisely the graph of T bar, okay? All right, so I wanted to just put a proof in there because we haven't proved anything. We've just been regurgitating material from everywhere else, and we hadn't really seen a proof, so I thought it's good to put at least a proof in here. So the remainder of the lecture, I want to really talk about a very important notion that we're going to be using throughout, and that's a notion of duality. It's a notion of duality and perfect pairings. Okay, so, oops. Okay, so, So this inner product notation, I'm gonna recycle here as it is done in the literature. So suppose that this is a K-linear map. So that means that so it's conjugate linear if K is equal to C, right? So conjugation in the second variable here. So suppose that we have such a k-linear map. So I'm going to define, okay, sorry, I should move the definition here. Sorry about that. So, okay, actually, let me leave it. So let me define a perfect pairing. So, no, it's not bilinear. It's k-linear. Because if it's bilinear, then it's linear in both variables. So the question was, do I mean bilinear? No, it's conjugate linear. So it's like an inner product. If you take an inner product for a Hilbert space, it's conjugate linear in the second variable. It's not bilinear. So it's linear in the first variable and conjugate linear in the second variable. Yes, or conjugate linear, antilinear, these are all synonyms for this concept, right? Or k-linear, if there's a complex number in front, typically c-linearity means that you take the conjugation in the second variable. Okay, so perfect pairings are denoted as such, is a perfect pair or a duality. So in literature, it's sometimes also called duality if the following are satisfied. So there exists a constant C naught, finite constant, such that UV is bounded against this B1. Oops, this is V, B2. So the question was, is it a subset of the field? No, it's not a subset of the field. It's a map that takes one value in B1 and one value in B2. It's linear in B1 and conjugate linear in B2. So this is the notation, right? Okay, sorry. Let me just say this is the notation. So I'm defining this, right? This is the notation. When we have a perfect pairing, we denote it by putting in B1 and B2 here to say that there is a perfect pairing between B1 and B2. So this is notation. Sorry for the confusion, right? This is just notation. It's not taking in subsets of B1, it's defined on B1 and B2. But when we have a perfect pairing, we denote it by writing bracket B1, bracket B2 to say that this is a K-linear mapping between B1 and B2, satisfying these following three axioms that I will write. So it's just a notational device. So, okay, so getting back to the definition, so there exists a C naught satisfying this estimate for all U in B1 and for all V in B2. The second point is that there exists some constant C1 such that the norm of B1 can be written by taking the supremum over this pairing, such that the norm of V of B1 is equal to 1 for V in a dense subset of B1. Right? So we can do this over any dense subset. And the third point is there exists a C2 such that the norm of B2 can be recovered in a similar way, where we take the supremum again over this U and V, such that now we take the norm, this is the norm of, in item 2, it's the norm on B2, right? Because V is coming from B2. So here we're taking B1 equals 1 for u in dense subset of B1. Okay, so the whole point is that this often makes it, when we have nice dense subsets of Banach spaces, it often, this, and we have pairings, it allows us to easily compute norms of things by passing to the dense subsets, by pairing against something else. Okay, so, I'll make that remark. So what are examples? Yes, question? No, the second and the third does not follow, because the first one is asking for this. So the question was, does the second and third follow from the first? And it doesn't, because the first one is saying that this pairing is bounded above. But the number two and number three is saying that we can recover the norm itself from the pairing, right? So that's really like a bound from below. So, just an example, some examples. So, something we know and love, H is a Hilbert space. And the usual inner product is a perfect pairing. Okay, if we now move to the LP spaces, if we take the inner product on L2, so this induces, and the reason for this we will see later, I won't prove this right now, but we'll see the reason for this later. So this induces a perfect pairing when P is in the range of 1 to infinity, not inclusive, between LP, M, or PQ, E cross LQ, ME, for 1 on P plus 1 on Q equals to 1. Okay. The question is what we call the perfect pairing the bilinear map? The perfect pairing is a bilinear map satisfying these three axioms. Okay. Or a duality. It's also called a duality. So a very, very important perfect pairing is given, I'm going to now write two things here, just because I want to highlight this. So in the first slot, we take the dual space. And in the second slot, we take the space itself. And what is this perfect pairing given by? This is given by... this is defined by simply the action of T on U. Okay, so this I will call the canonical pairing. I don't know if that's language that's used in the literature, but just so we have a name. So I think in the course of doing function analysis and so on and so forth, I'm certain that you would have seen pairings between dual elements and vectors and dual vectors written in this form, in this inner product form. And that's really because you can write this and you can see this as a perfect pair. So personally for me, I mean, I don't know if it's the same for you, but this was always a bit of a mystery to me until I started really understanding perfect pairs, why one writes it in this way. So with respect to the perfect pairing, we have something called an adjoint, right? That's a canonical. So now we want to mix operator theory with with these dualities. So so let me just first make a definition. So S adjoint to T, okay? So let T be a map from B1 to B2, and S be a map from B2 star to B1 star. So these are operators, unbounded operators, right? So they have a domain. So whenever I write operators, I mean that in general, they're unbounded. So now let me write this in brackets just so we don't lose a picture of what's going on. So we have VTU. So this is the pairing we wrote before, SVU. So this is going to be SV acting on U. And we have this for, we ask this to be satisfied for all U in the domain of T, which is in B1, and for all V in the domain of S, which is contained in B2. Okay, so then we say S is adjoint to T. So it's really important that it is adjoint or is a adjoint, because there could be lots of different adjoints and they might not be equal. Okay, so that's really an important thing to drive home here. However, if T is densely defined, then there exists a unique maximal adjoint. I'll call it T star C. So the C here is because it's a canonical pairing. So what does that mean? So that means that, i.e., if S is adjoint to T, then S is contained in T star of C. Okay, so this is what I mean by maximal. So every adjoint to T is contained in this T star. So what is this object, right? So let's we can really construct this T star. So the domain of T star of C, these are going to be exactly the V in B2 in the adjoint space, such that there exists a V tilde in B1 of star, such that maybe I'll write such that V of TU is equal, sorry, maybe I'll call this V tilde W. I'll call it W, sorry. W of U for all U in the domain of T. This is because this is the so the question was, what does the C stand for in this notation? It's because this is the canonical, this is with respect to the canonical pairing between the dual space and or the adjoint space and itself. So this is an adjoint with respect to a fixed pairing, right? Later on, we want to move to more arbitrary pairings, but here this is really with the canonical pairing. So the question is, why is this so the object that I'm going to define, I want it to be well defined. So it's well defined for the following reason. So suppose that W prime is an element of B star, such that this relation holds again for that, right? So we have that V of TU also equals W prime of U. But we have also that this is equal to W of U. And we assumed that U was a dense subset. Okay, and this is really where the second axiom of the dual pairing really comes into play, because then this allows us to assert, because the domain of U, so since U in Dom T and Dom T is dense, this implies that W prime has to be equal to W, right? It's linear pairing, so we can just subtract the two from each other, and then we get that the norm of W prime minus W has to be equal to zero. Okay, so that means that for V in this, the V in the domain of this T star, we can define T star of C of V equal to this W that we have. Okay, so let me also emphasize that this object can be zero. Okay, it might be that the domain of T star of C is zero. That can happen. Okay. So what about more general pairings? Okay, so general pairings. So non-example. So let's recall. So how are we doing with time? Okay, we have 15 minutes. So let's think about the situation of a general pairing. So let's recall the space C naught. So this is the sequence space. So for n in n, such that xn converges to zero. And this, along with the supremum norm, is a Banach space. So two facts which you can verify to yourself. So the dual space of this is really little L1. So as we said before, we have this canonical pairing now between L1 and C0, right? Because we can identify the dual space. Now suppose we set up a map T from L1 into L1, given by T of U is equal to the sum J equals 1 to infinity UI 0. Okay, so this is now a map that maps back into L1. But now let's see if we can find a duality for this. So suppose that T prime goes from C0 to C0, such that T of U V is equal to U of T prime of V. So T of U V here, so what's the right hand side? So the left hand side, this is going to be equal to sum of I ui, so I equals 1 to infinity times v1, right? That's all we're going to have. And on the left hand side, what we have is we have the sum I ui, and let me call this sum vi tilde. Okay, so from the comparison of these two expressions, we see that the vi tilde has to be equal to v1. But if the vi tilde is equal to v1, then such a sequence, so the sequence v1 does not satisfy that the limit goes to zero, so this is not in C0. right? So in general, the take-home message is we cannot have dual maps or adjoins when we change the duality. But actually, this example highlights a point, and the point really is that the failure here is really reflexivity. Okay, so these spaces are not reflexive. So C naught is the adjoint of C naught is L1. Sorry, the adjoint space of C naught is L1, but the adjoint space of L1 is L infinity. Right. So it's really reflexivity that's sits at the heart of all of this. So, what can we do when things are reflexive? Okay. So let B1 and B2 be a perfect pair. So let me define now B1 into B2 star phi of 1 u acting on v is equal to just uv in the pairing, and so this is 1, and phi of 2 b 2 into b1 star phi 2 of x acting on y is precisely equal to yx conjugate, right? I put the conjugate, so of course if it's real then we the conjugation does nothing, right? So I'm putting the conjugation there because we want these maps to be linear. Otherwise, if we didn't have the conjugation, the map phi 2 will be antilinear. Okay. So I'll leave it up to you to verify that, in the interest of time in particular, and it's not a hard exercise anyway, that B1, B2 star, and phi 2, B2 in B1 star are closed linear subspaces. Okay, with respect to their relevant topologies. But now comes the really important, the very important thing. So when B1 and B2 if B1, B2 is a perfect pair, and B2 is reflexive, then this happens if and only if B1 is reflexive, and we have that phi 1 of B1 is equal to B2 star, and phi 2 of B2 is equal to B1 star. Okay, so actually this is a consequence of the Hahn-Banach theorem under reflexivity. And the reflexivity of B1 simply follows from actually proving this statement, assuming B2 is reflexive. Because then you can take the adjoint of this again, and then you can get back to So one can keep taking adjoints to get back to the relevant spaces. Okay, or duals. So now we can start thinking about dual maps with respect to arbitrary pairings, right? So So if B2 is reflexive and we have a perfect pair B1, B2, maybe I don't need to write this anymore because this notation means we have a perfect pair, Then for an operator B2 into itself, densely defined, there exists some closed maximal T star that takes me from B1 back into itself. Okay, so this is why I wrote T star C for the canonical object. Okay, so satisfying T star of U V is equal to U V U T V. And this is for all U in DOM T, for all V, sorry, all V in DOM T, all U in DOM T star. And what is, so I have to give you what the domain is, right? So everything here is very constructive. So the domain is precisely just taking this phi 1 inverse and pulling back the domain of the T star of C. Oops. And what is the map? I can also explicitly describe the map. So this map is precisely phi 1 inverse composed with this T star C composed with phi 1. Okay, so you can check that this is maximal, because if there is another maximal operator, then you can do the same trick and pull it across via the map phi 1 to the adjoint space, and you can contradict the maximality of the operator T star of C. Okay, so this is a very important construction, because it tells us exactly the failure for the, or the potential failure for the existence of a dual map, right? Because what can happen is that if the phi 1 is not a surjection, so we have that under reflexivity, but if it fails to be a surjection, then there's no way of pulling this domain back, right? It could be that this is not defined everywhere, and it might not be defined where the canonical adjoint is defined. So okay, so what's the corollary of this? So the corollary of this, so if we have B1 equals B2 equals the Hilbert space H, then T star is the usual adjoint with respect to just the Hilbert space inner product. Okay, so in some sense, this is like a Ries representation theorem, but it's very explicit. And you can also see that, you know, the canonical adjoint always exists, and when you change your metric, so there's a geometric flavor to this, right? This is really a metric here. This is really a geometric structure on your pair of spaces, and the existence of the T star really absorbs that information. Okay, and the way it does it is with this isomorphism phi 1, and it's really about pulling back a canonically existing object at the level of the adjoint space. Okay, so in the remaining 10 minutes, let me just finish up by talking about a related and important concept when we have a pairing. So this is also something that we will use. So, and it's the definition of an annihilator. Okay, so so let's take a perfect pairing and subspace S in B1. So for that, we can define the annihilated subspace with respect to this inner product, or sorry, to this perfect pairing, not inner product. So these are exactly the y in B2 such that x and y is 0 for all x in S. Okay, so now what you can do is you can calculate from this. So this is not hard to do, so I will leave this. This is a closed subspace, and in fact the closure of this set S is contained in S perp and this is again equal to just taking the annihilator with respect to the closed subspace, right? So okay. But we want to say something under reflexivity, right? So now let's get back to the situation where we have something being reflexive. So let B1 or B2 be reflexive. And we have a pair B1, B2. So then the first thing that we have is that phi 2 of this annihilator with respect to this pairing is exactly equal pairing here. And the second thing I want to say is that if we now take the annihilator and then again the annihilator, this is actually equal to the closure. Okay, so the proof of one. So I think we have time to prove this. Yes, we have 5 minutes now, a bit more. Okay, so the proof of one. So what is this space? Yes. S is a subspace. So we take any subspace of B1, and then the annihilator is just elements in B2 such that it kills S under this annihilator, under this pairing. Okay, so this is precisely equal to the Y in B1 star such that XY 0 for all x in S. So what's that again? So let's just recall that this is exactly the pairing, just the pairing given by that. So now I'm going to write this as y in B1 star. And now I'm going to just write it as phi 2. I mean, I'm not doing anything super interesting here of y acting on x equals 0 for all x in S. And here's where we really use, so this is really where we use So what are we using here? So we use here that, right? So I'm going to use here that phi 2 takes me from B2 to B1 star isomorphically, and that phi 2 of y of x is precisely, y is probably a bad choice here. Z of x is exactly equal to x, y, x, z conjugate. Okay, so now I'm going to write this as B1 such that okay, so this is going to be x phi 2 inverse of y 0 for all x in S. Well, and then we can read off from this, right, that this is phi 2 inverse of precisely. The notation, this pairing with the two brackets is the canonical pairing of the dual space with the space. Okay. So we don't have a huge amount of time left, but let me just say that for proving the second point here, what we always find, so a fact is that S, if we annihilate S, so let me erase this very quickly. So let me first think about the canonical pairing between B1 star and B1. And now we take the annihilator with respect to B1 star star and B1 star. Okay, so this intersect with the image of the evaluational functional that takes us into, that embeds B into the bijoule. This is exactly equal to the evaluational functional acting on the closure of S. Okay, so this is EV that takes us from B to the bijoule. If we recall, it's just X acting on Y is just YX. So we're assuming reflexivity though. So reflexive means that EV of B is exactly equal to B star star. So then we're done, right? From this, if we unravel things, we get the statement that we want. Okay. So as a closing remark, let me just give a nice way of trying to think about these dual maps. Okay, so now that we have these annihilators, so we identify B1 cross B2 with B1 cross B2. So if we now have T that's densely defined, then the canonical adjoint, so the canonical adjoint T star of C, which takes us from B2 star back to B1 star, is given by the inverse graph of negative T star canonical, which is what? Which is where we swap the x and y, so negative t star c here, such that u is in the domain of this t star c, is equal to the graph of t annihilated now with respect to this, right? So with respect to B1 cross B2 dual B1 cross B2. Okay, so this is without any reflexivity or anything like that, right? I mean, this is just in general, right? So from this if we have a T going from B2 to B2, densely defined, and we have a pairing B1, B2, and B1 is reflexive, or B2 is reflexive, then we have that the inverse graph of the negative T star is equal to the graph of T annihilated now with respect to B1, B2. Okay, I will end the lecture there. Thank you very much for your attention, and sorry about this technical kerfuffles today. So I think I've sorted out the quality of the video, but there's a few more things to iron out. Thank you. Okay, the question was, what is the norm on the adjoint space? So it's the induced norm, right? Because there you have, okay, so the norm on the adjoint space. Maybe I should write that down. So B star, this is going to be phi, taking us from B to K conjugate linear. So, and continuous, right? So continuous and bounded are, of course, the same thing, as I mentioned before. So then the norm, the induced norm of the on the B star is simply the soup. So it's really the norm of this acting on X, such that the norm of X is equal to the norm of X in, so absolute value here, sorry, in B is equal to 1. Okay, no worries. Okay, so thanks for that question. So the question was, if we have a real valued function, can we see this as a section of a vector bundle? Absolutely. So the bundle you want to consider, if it's real valued or complex valued, is the bundle M cross R or M cross C if it's complex valued, right? So sections of this, sections of E are precisely going to be functions from M to K. Well, I mean, so the map here, of course, remembers it, right? So what is a section? So if I have a section, So I should say this can be identified with functions. Yes, yeah, but certainly that's true. But I mean the fiber here is always K. So when we have a section, so if Y is a section of E, then I'm saying that phi of X is in E of X. But here, if I'm looking at the vector bundle here, then this is equal to R. So these are exactly functions. Yeah. So that's a good question. And in fact, you can see here why it's not enough just to look at CN valued or RN valued objects when you're on a manifold. Because if you're on a contractible space, then the only vector bundles that you get for a given dimension are exactly these trivial ones, right? C to the power of the dimension or R to the power of the dimension. But if you're on a manifold, you can have lots of vector bundles that don't agree with that. I mean, the sphere is the two sphere is the quintessential example there. Yeah. Okay, so if there's no more questions, we can wrap up. Aha, yeah, please, yeah. Mm-hmm. Precisely. So the question was the absolute value in the definition of the inner product. So remember, I wrote that if I have H, which is a Hermitian product on E, then I'm going to write H of X UU. Sorry, I'm going to write the absolute value of H of X as equal to the square root of hx uu for u on the fiber E of X. Yeah. Okay, so if there are no more questions, let's wrap up for today. Thank you. See you next Monday.